year at the age of 46. He was cremated and his ashes were scattered on the Pacific Ocean. Buster Keaton, his longtime friend, firmly believed that he had died from a broken heart. So, to many people's minds, if Virginia Rappe was murdered, it was after her death by yellow journalism and a lynch mob public. Before the third trial of Fatty Arbuckle got underway, this man was found dead on his living room floor with a .38 caliber slug in his back. As near as could be determined, the shot was fired at about 9 o'clock on the evening of February 1st, 1922. At the time of his death, he lived at this location on Alvarado Street, which used to be luxury apartments in an exclusive neighborhood. He was a top motion picture director, described by those who knew him as an idealist, a gentleman, and very well liked, except, obviously, for the one who murdered him. He was born in Ireland as William Cunningham Dean Tanner, lived in New York till the age of 36, then came to Hollywood. He changed his name to William Desmond Taylor and became an actor. And very quickly, he became a director. He directed such stars as Mary Pickford, Douglas Fairbanks, and Mary Miles Minter. Taylor was on top of the world. So how did it come to this? Who murdered him? And what was his or her motive? The single bullet that killed Taylor came from a .38 caliber gun. A neighbor heard the shot, but assumed that it was the backfire of a passing motor car. His valet, Henry Peavy, discovered his body in the early morning hours of the following day. Before long, the police, and especially the press, had compiled a list of suspects as varied and as intriguing as any murder mystery movie. Among them was the beautiful Mary Miles Minter, 22, who many believed was the next Mary Pickford. Taylor had directed her, and she was in love with him. She wrote him love letters. But he never gave in to her sexual advances. Was Mary a woman scorned, as in hell knows no fury? Then there was Mary's overly protective stage mother, Charlotte Shelby. She was afraid that her daughter would be compromised and her career ruined by Taylor, a man more than twice Mary's age. And a gun Charlotte owned was a .38. Did the butler do it? Henry Peavy, who was first to discover the body. He had the time and the opportunity, but they couldn't find a motive. Or was it drug-addicted Mabel Norman, one of Hollywood's top comedians? Norman was at Taylor's apartment about the time of the murder, and she was the last known person to see him alive. Edward F. Sands became a prime suspect. Taylor had given Sands, a down-and-out acquaintance from Army days, a job as his houseman. But then Sands stole several thousand dollars, disappeared, and was never questioned nor apprehended. It all happened over 80 years ago, but amateur sleuths still comb through the facts, the evidence, the hearsay, forever trying to prove who it was, and who it wasn't, that murdered William Desmond Taylor. Down through the years, a persistent dark rumor in Hollywood involves an alleged murder at sea, aboard a 200-foot yacht. The killer, it was believed, was too big to meddle with, and so he got away with it. He had been called a Roman emperor living in the 20th century, William Randolph Hearst, the most powerful media mogul in America. And this man, Thomas Ince, a celebrated movie producer-director, was the one who ended up dead. The yacht, the Oneida, belonged to Hearst. The weekend cruise from Los Angeles to San Diego was to celebrate Ince's 43rd birthday. In addition to the crew and a jazz band, there was an array of Agatha Christie-like characters, including Luella Parsons, before she became the Luella Parsons, making and breaking celebrity careers with her gossip column. At the time, she worked as a movie columnist for Hearst in New York. This was her first trip to Hollywood. Charlie Chaplin, the most famous actor in the world. In addition to his comic brilliance, it was well known that Charlie was quite a ladies' man. Actress Marion Davies, whose star was rising high, due in large part to Hearst, who lavished publicity about her in his newspapers. She was his mistress and the apple of his eye.